by Evangelist Ralph Barnard of Winston-Salem, North Carolina. His subject is Dead Men Tell No Tales, or The Power of a Holy Life.
The 16th chapter of Luke chapter 16. And we wish to read together the last part of the story our Lord Jesus told about the destiny of two men, one whose name was Lazarus, the other Spirit did not see fit to name. One of them fared sumptuously here on the earth, and he died, the Spirit. The other was a beggar, he died and was buried. And the Lord Jesus lifts the curtain between eternity and time, lets us see that their situations were reversed, and the one who was fared so well in this life, suffering torments in the life to come, and the one who was a beggar in this life, feasting on the riches of God's goodness for his people. One of the men, the rich man, does not cry to get out of hell, but he cries that his sufferings may be relieved. And the answer is that when a man dies, all the mercy that God has for men and women is this side of the grave. And the other answer is that there is a great gulf, and it's fixed. It cannot be moved, and there cannot be any travel between the land of bliss and the land of torment. In other words, this rich man is assured here in this passage of Scripture that his destiny is sealed, that there shall be no surcease from his awful, awful torment. Then, beginning with verse 27, this rich man is made to turn his attention back to this old earth. Having found out there's no hope for him, he turns and he speaks in this wise. Then he said, I pray thee, therefore, Father, that thou wouldst send him to my father's house. He asked that the Father send Lazarus back to from heaven to hell, and touch his finger and water. Come and bring that finger that has touched water, and bring it and put it on his parched tongues. And so that couldn't happen. So he said, all right, I pray thee, therefore, Father, thou wouldst send him to my father's house, back down on the earth, by a five brothers, that he may testify unto them, lest also they come into this place of torment. Abraham says unto them, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. He said, no, Father Abraham, but they won't listen to them, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. He said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. There is a sentence in that expression that we cannot get around. That is, that the only escape from the torments of the life to come is the exercise of real and genuine and lasting and heartfelt repentance in this life. This man said, if you send somebody from the dead and let him testify to them, they'll repent. He's saying that they're in hell, that I'm in hell because I didn't repent. He's saying they're headed for hell, and the only way of escape is Bible repentance. We're living in a generation going to wind up in hell. Your neighbors are going to wind up in hell. Your children, many of them reared in Sunday school, but more interested in the things of the world than in the things of God. It amazes you to see youngsters now when we tell they're saved because they've made a profession of faith. And we do not see them in time except on Sunday morning. And They're at home tonight, glued to a television or a radio, or they're doing something, or they're getting their lessons, or they're down at the movies, or they're gone to see Grandma, and yet we call them Christians. And we find out, we do not recognize that this is the day when men make professions but do not repent, when men claim Jesus but do not turn from their sins, when men claim to be saved but hold on to their darling lust, when we say we believe the gospel but we do it apart from a heart forsaking, turning from our sins. No one is saved who has not turned from all of his sins in such a way as to never go back to them. There's no going back in the service of the Lord Jesus Christ. No one is saved who can be happy in any kind of sin. Is that right? That's so. And we're living in a generation now where people are going to hell. We're sending to hell from our churches. They're going to hell from our homes. They're going to hell all about us because they've missed repentance. They've missed repentance. And the only way on earth, listen to me, the only way on earth they're going to be kept out of hell is by the churches of the living God, either becoming full of saved people or full of people who are obedient. I look in your faces tonight, and I know every last one of you are in the same shape I'm in. You either need to be saved, you miss Christ, or you need to be obedient and walk in paths of holiness and come to areas of consecration you never heard about, and learn to love the word holiness instead of make fun of it. That's what we need, isn't it? My friends, the only hope is for the churches to get on fire. Somebody said that the test of whether the gospel will work on the outside world will be determined by how it works inside. And our churches today do not have a testimony now. Nobody's afraid of us. Nobody much is under conviction because of the holy garments that the people in our churches wear today. Sinners are not screaming for mercy but watching us live. We talk with them, we walk with them, we have intercourse with them. We invite them to our services and they know that it's not much reality and this generation's going to hell as surely as I'm standing here, unless the fire can be started in the house of God. There's never been a revival since time began that is advertised. Revivals are when the fire starts. People come to see a fire. People will come to see a fire. Most places I go, the whole meeting, church day, the membership are nice. They let us have the building to hold the meeting in. And most of them don't show up Sunday morning. Some of them fewer show up Sunday night. Monday night, not so many. And if we get crowds, we have to get them from this. You go to Burlington, you can't get a corporal's guard where these folks come from unless they have a few of the members. This has come from other churches. And we call it revival. The world's going to hell because it's missed repentance. And we cannot expect our houses of worship to be filled to overflowing with men and women hungering and thirsting after God until the churches once more either get full of saved people or the ones of us who are saved get filled with the Spirit and the Lordship of Jesus Christ shall be regnant and march on our forehead. And people say, there's somebody been bent to the rule of Jesus Christ. And brother, this world, when it sees the gospel work inside our churches, it'll come to watch the fire burn. Now we're down to just that. We've tried everything else. Some evangelists I know would not think of trying to hold a gospel service without having a movie. Most of them have a movie every night. They say we can't get people to come to hear the word of God, and we can't unless the fire is built. We can't unless God's got some people that are saved and hungry and thirsty and ready to confess every known sin and ready to be done with everything that there's any doubt about. We're such broad-minded people now. And the only difference on earth between us and the outside world is we claim to be Christians and they don't. Neither one of us know much about it. And all that while, the world's going to hell. I want us to think pretty seriously tonight about this very simple statement. This world's going to hell because it's missing the Bible way of repentance. And the only thing between this generation and hell is the testimony of people who know what repentance is by experience, who know what it is to hate sin and run from it and live godly, holy lives, and whose lives by the holiness of them will strike conviction in the hearts of people. Is that what you want? I think that we cannot go on too much longer now, turning wheels within wheels, having our Sunday school and preaching, our training union preaching, our prayer meeting, our so-called revival meetings, and we come in and go out like we came. We do not need God. And we do not know what holiness is now. This is a generation where people are afraid of holiness and not afraid of sin. We'll never see the Shekinah glory of God in our churches, and the world will never come to see what's going on until we walk again in paths of holiness. The only thing between this generation and hell, the only hope of winning this generation, is that the fire of the Holy Ghost shall be started in the meeting houses that we call churches of the Lord Jesus Christ. I wonder if I'm speaking to anybody at night claiming to be a Christian, and there's the least thing in your life about which there's any question at all. Brother, you better get out on your knees. You better not leave this house tonight. If you do, and you ask me to come here to lead you in revival, and you're a member of this church, and you one of these church members going around here and saying, I don't think there's anything wrong with this, and I don't think there's any more harm in this and this and that, and I don't think God will send me to hell for this, and I don't believe this is as bad as something else, why, it's a judgment. It'll be terrible when God charges you with the blood of sinners on your hands. Oh, my God. Think of it. This world, hell and gone, missed repentance, and the only hope is for people who know repentance. They hate all sin. They hate every kind of sin. They run from every kind of sin. You can't get them to entertain the idea of sin. They've met God. They know what a heart forsaking of sin is. They're not willing to be guilty of anything about which the least possible question can be raised by God or man. Oh, my soul. That Christianity, that's the evidence of salvation. These men and women run up down this country that smoke the same brand that the world does, drink the same brand the world does, go to the same shows the world goes, listen to the same things the world listens, talk the same language the world listens. They advertise the mockery of religion. They do not advertise bloodstained Jesus. And they're helping, not only going to hell themselves, but they're dragging everybody they know along with them. And the only hope of rescuing the perishing and care for the dying and seeing a breath of revival and seeing men thrust into the kingdom of God in your day and mine is the people who know God in repentance and faith and hate sin with all their souls, every kind of sin, and run from it and love God and bear the mark and rule of His reign in their lives, filled with the Spirit, shall lift up thy voices in testimony to this generation. I listen to a man talk about things of eternity. If I know him, and I know the gospel's work for him. I listen to a man if I know that he's been brought to the place he hates sin. I listen to a man if I can see in his life the marks of his devotion to and love for the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the only kind of people this world will listen to. Ladies and gentlemen of Calvary Baptist Church, you need not expect God to visit in revival power. If there's a person here who's willing to engage in anything about which there's any question, there are two statements in one verse of Scripture in the Bible that mark a child of God. Let me quote it. Nevertheless, the foundation standeth sure. The Lord knoweth them that are His. And let everyone that nameth the name of the Lord depart from all iniquity. This is a generation, listen to me, This is a generation of so-called Christians who want to do everything they possibly can and still not go to hell. People come to me and say, Brother Barnum, will God send me to hell for doing so-and-so? And I say, yeah, he'll send you. Not for doing so-and-so, because you show you've never repented. If you'd repented, you wouldn't want to be finding out how much sin you could do and still get to heaven. You want to be finding out how far you could run from sin. God looks at the heart. God looks at the heart. Oh, hear me. Hear me. This is serious with me. This is serious with me. God bless your heart. I burn about this. My heart bleeds about it. Listen to me. This generation going to hell, and the churches of the living God waiting in worldliness, making fun of holiness, sneering at godliness, broad-minded, so broad, without having enough cheese to spread on the crackers, and we've lost our testimony, and nobody pays much attention to us. And that's heartbreaking when I remember that the prayer of this rich man is, he said on the human side, I know there's nothing that can reach my five brethren except testimony by somebody that knows what he's talking about. It's heartbreaking when you face the fact that the only thing on the human side, boy, you and I have got any part of entering into, to keep men and women all about us from spending eternity in hell. The only thing is our testimony. Our testimony. God help us. If it gives a broad-minded sound, if it gives an uncertain sound, if it gives a weak sound, if that body is not lives that live or lived in proof that this gospel is the message of a supernatural death by a supernatural God and the work of the Spirit, a miracle of supernatural grace transforming men and women so that they live not commonplace lives but supernatural lives, lives that cannot be lived except by men who've met God and who know God in their experience. Listen to me. Listen to me. That's what we need tonight. That's what we got to have. If that's what you want to pray for, if that's what you want to confess to, if that's what you're after, then it's not a mockery. But if we think that we can pull the wool over God's eyes and get men born into the kingdom of God over our unconfessed sins, over our broad-minded living, over our non-fellowship one with another, over our making fun of holiness, over our refusing with anointed lips to witness to the supernatural work of grace that's been wrought in our hearts that transformed us, and we know if it'll work in us, it'll work in somebody else. If we're not willing to do that, it's mockery to have church services. It's mockery to say we're going to entertain the hope of a revival meeting. Amen? That's right. That's right. Now, the two things tonight. First of all, if anybody's going to testify to this generation, it'll have to be us. If anybody's going to pray for men today, it'll have to be us. Dead people are not going to come back to do our praying for us. Dead people are not going to come back to testify to our loved ones for us. This man said, send Lazarus back and let him testify to my brothers. And Abraham said, no, no, that's not the way God works. That's not the way God works. Lazarus is done here too, and now he's in glory. He's done all the witnessing he'll ever do. And God's not going to raise people from the dead to do the praying for this generation. God's not going to raise people from the dead to do the preaching to this generation. God's not going to raise godly, holy men of old who saw revival and paid the price and felt the breath of God and walked under the rule of Christ and saw him move mountains and fill up valleys and swept scores of people into the kingdom of God. It's not enough for us to read about them and pray that God will send them back. If anybody's going to warn this generation, if anybody's going to testify to this generation, if anybody's going to weep over this generation, if anybody's going to pray for this generation, if anybody's going to keep men out of hell with their bodies transformed and live out of God, it's the men and women who know God in this day. In this day, if anybody's going to witness in this community, it'll have to be the same people in the churches around here. If anybody's going to pray for them around here, you can't import somebody to do it for you. I was in Utica, New York, some years since. and they took me down to a woolen mill 100 years before. Charles Finney, God's greatest gift to evangelism, had been in Utica. It's not a very big place at that time, city of 150,000 people when I was in it. And he held a meeting, so did I. Nobody found out much I was in town. We had all the churches in the city believed in anything. They came together, had a big auditorium, spent a lot of money on an advertising, got me on the radio, and passed out handbills, and did a lot of things. Not many folks ever found out we were having a meeting. Just went right on. And I went down, got a card. I had to get a card, and one of the pastors took me through a woolen mill. 100 years before that, Charles Finney is in the city, and he'd been in that self-same woolen mill, and the Spirit of God was so working all over that city off Utica that when Mr. Finney stepped in the building, all the workers, becoming acquainted with his presence, quit working on the spinning wheels, the looms, whatever they were, and just got down on the feet. Sobbed and prayed under conviction. People everywhere. And the owner of the spinning of the woolen mill came to Mr. Finney and begged him to talk with the people and help them know how to be saved. He said they do nothing but cry and bawl and pray. And he said, I can't keep my factory running. And said, I'm interested in thy souls. And said, they're seeking the Lord. And Mr. Finney, when he went in there, they begged him to show him how to be saved. I had to get me a card, and they forbade me to give out any tracts and told me not to speak to anybody and disturb them. You see the difference in Finney and me. Finney had the power of God, and I don't have much of it. Finney turned the city upside down, and nobody much found out I was there. Finney goes inside a woolen mill, and the people begin to scream and pray and beg him to pray God to have mercy upon them. And I stood there and thought of the contrast, and I closed my eyes as my hot tears came on my face, and I prayed, oh God, if it please thee, raise Charles Finney from his grave and send him back to America. Maybe he can call men to repentance. And they listened to him. The answer came back as you know it would. Charles Finney served his generation. He's gone to his reward. If anybody gonna witness and preach to this generation, it'll be little preachers like you. Oh, my. That's right, Brother Meade. That's right, Brother Kettner. I don't know the big preacher on the top side of the earth now. I don't know a man can get a crowd. I don't know anybody's got much power on him now. We're just little bitty, two-bit Christians feeling our way. But all in all, the blessing of God is what we heard from somebody else. We've never seen revival fires. We just been going through the mountains and the world passes by. It doesn't even so much as honk a horn to recognize what's going on. And we're just like little babies trembling without breath. But this I know, that all the witnessing and preaching this generation will ever hear will have to come from men who are alive today. Charles Finney is not coming back. Dead men tell no tales. I lived for 3 years in Rochester, New York, wife and I, and before our last child, the woman I have now, was born, she traveled with me. We had an apartment in Rochester, New York, over the space of 3 years. And one time when I was there between meetings, an old deacon, 93 years of age, said, I want to go show you some things. And I took him in my car, the old man, pretty old now, 93, and we drove over the city, and he told me about what happened when Charles Finney held a revival in Rochester, New York. He said, I was a kid of a boy, but he said, I remember it. And he took me, now listen, this sounds like I'm making it up, but he took me to the places right in the heart of the city now. And he showed me, he said, this is the spot, and over here is the spot. He said, go down yonder, yonder's another spot, and over here is another spot. And he showed me places long since repainted now. But he said in the meetings, nearly 90 years ago, he said God's people wore out the pavement with their knees, praying for the souls of men. Oh, he said businessmen going about their business, they'd meet together, Next thing you know, they'd be down on their knees right on the sidewalks and pavements, absolutely oblivious to everything. Sister, much of it went on in that 6 month revival campaign where over 100,000 souls came to God. He said they were so oblivious of business and everything else that they wrestled so, not knowing it, that they literally wore the pavement down with their knees. And he said women going to market and going about the town, they'd congregate in little groups, and next thing you know, they'd be on their knees. And said the women wore out the sidewalks and pavements with their knees, crying to God for souls. And I stood there, so help me God, and sobbed like my heart would break. And in my heart went up a prayer, oh God, praise those praying men and women. Oh, send them back to America to pray for this generation. Nobody's got time to pray now. We've lost Europe. We don't know how. We got the word of God. And the answer came back, I'm not going to raise those people back. They served their generation. If anybody is the price for this last generation today, we'll have to find them in the circle of our churches. My God, it's solemn to me. There have been days when men love the souls of men. May God send those days back. There have been days when men prayed, real prayer, agonizing prayer for the souls of men. Send those days back. And the answer comes. If anybody prays for sinners now, it'll have to come out of this generation of blood-bought, twice-born men and women. Dead men are not going to come back and promote revival. Dead men are not going to come back and call people to repentance. Dead men are not going to come back and wear out tables with their knees praying for men and women. But brother, we've got no right to say God can't give revival until we are willing to do what had to be done by God's people in every generation, to see an outpouring of the Holy Spirit of God. I tell you, my friends, an atmosphere of Holy Spirit power in a church of God is the only thing between this generation and hell. I went some years ago to Anderson, Indiana. It's my first experience preaching in a United Brethren church. I got a letter from the pastor. It happened to be the second largest United Brethren church in America. He told me so in his letter. Great big church. And he wrote and asked me if I could come to him for a series of meetings, which he hoped the Lord would bless. So I sat down and wrote him a letter, and I said, I never preached in a United Brethren church, and I'm a Baptist, and I'm a strict Calvinist, as they call it. And I just do not know enough about what you people believe. And I thought maybe you did not know enough about me. And I would be a gentleman if I came, but I would not want to embarrass anybody. I would never like to go to anybody's church and preach so as to embarrass God's people. I recognize I don't know everything. I recognize you could differ with me, still be right. I recognize you could differ with me and we could still be saved. I recognize that wisdom didn't come to an end with me. But I wouldn't want to come and my message be directly something you do not believe. And I thought that'd be the last of that. And he wrote me back. He said, now, I knew what you believed. I read lots of your sermons and I've been led of the Lord that your message would be a blessing to our church. And he said, we differ some doctrinally, but said we love the same Lord. And he said, if you come do the preaching, we'll do the praying, and we'll do the witness. And sure enough, I went, and I started on Sunday morning. I'll never forget, they had a Methodist song leader from Indianapolis, a Baptist preacher in a United Brethren church. They had two great big choirs, a tremendous thing, and I call one of them the Black Legion and the other the Ku Klux Klan. Somehow one choir was in white robes and the other was in black robes, and they didn't get mad at me. And I never will forget. Didn't have the doxology and thing. The pastor got up for the set of things, for the dead thing, and said, folks, he had a voice you could hear a country mile, and he said, we got a preacher with us for this meeting that never preached in a United Brethren church, and he's kind of scared. And I want everybody that wants him to know you'll pray for him, just get out on your knees and let's pray now. And there were about 1,200 people that looked at me like every one of them got out on their knees. The Ku Klux Klan got on their knees. They fixed their robes and the Black Legion got all theirs. And everybody! And of course, we Baptists wouldn't do that. We're too dead. Everybody prayed together. First time I'd ever been in a service like I never heard anything like it in my life. Wasn't any foolishness. Just prayed. They thought the Lord could hear them, you know. And about 1,200 people poured out their hearts to God. I never forget it. As long as I live. God saved a lot of people that first service. And that night, I was led to preach on the blackest sin out of hell. And a lot of those dead people claim to live above sin. That's a worthy claim. And I tell you right now, if you're not trying to live above sin, you're going to hell. I tell you that. You tell me you are saved and you are not striving with all your might to be perfect. You're just as lost as you can be. You have made it yet, though. But, brother, if you ain't trying, you've never been saved. You miss Christ. Christ don't save people and leave them satisfied and sin. There ain't no people that no Lord satisfied. No. But there's some of them, they claim to be above sin. And that night I preached on the sin, claiming to know Christ, and not bringing others to me. And I've been preaching about 20 minutes, and the old white-headed woman, I found out she is the old mother of Israel in the church. She began to talk. And directly she broke up my sermon. She came running down to the front, and she said, oh my God, I never saw it before. Said, I tried to walk right before God. I tried to keep my garment holy in the sight of God. That's worthy. I bless God for that. I'd rather be a fellow that hates sin so much that he thinks he's got the victory over it than one of these Baptists that brags about how he lives and claims once saved always. And so she said, I see it tonight. And she just stood there and soft and soft and soft. And finally she got control of herself. And she said, I've been guilty of the blackest sin out of hell, didn't know. She said, well, I've been occupied and trying to live a whole new life myself. I hadn't been concerned about bringing others to Christ. And she said, if God will forgive me, and if this church will forgive me, so help me God for now. My big concern is to live a whole new life and invest it in fishing for the souls of men. That's right, my friend. That's right. I try to keep the average church member from talking to anybody. They're in bad enough shape already. But if I can find somebody who knows God, I say, sick on fire. The only thing between this generation and hell is a testimony that somebody knows God. That dear old woman, you know what she did? She said, I'm going to call a prayer meeting. If anybody wants to meet me tomorrow night at 6:30. And the next night, 1,000 people were there. And I attended that prayer meeting. And every night, for 3 solid weeks, from 1,000 to 1,400, sometimes nearly 2,000 people, met there in that vast auditorium for 1 solid hour. Before the service began, and everybody prayed together. And I'm telling you the truth, I almost became a whore over May yet. They brought people from Indianapolis. They brought them from everywhere, not the healing services. I didn't know anything about it. Don't know much now. But they brought them to that meeting. And brothers and sisters, a sinner could not get in the atmosphere of that meeting without being saved. That's the God. I ain't never seen it in the Baptist church. I've never been to Baptist church where you could get anybody hardly to pray. I hope I've met my first. I've never been in a Baptist church where the people responded to the call to pray. I hope you will, yes. So help me, God, as a Baptist, I say it with shame. I've never held a meeting 23 years as an evangelist going up and down the country, Baptist churches, groups of Baptist churches. I got my first Baptist church yet to ever preach in that believes in prayer. I hope I've come to my first. I'm honest with you. Baptists don't pray. We don't pray. You call a prayer meeting, there'll be a half a dozen. Most of you got to read the paper at the same time. Smoke your pipe at the same time of night. Listen to the same program on the radio. Fall the old lady out of something. You haven't got time to pray. And brother, God's hand's not on us. His power's not upon us. And we're dying on our feet. Brother, they brought people from 100 miles around in that northern state of Indiana. And bless the Lord. All that you had to do was to get a sinner in the atmosphere there. And he said, oh, and want somebody to tell him how to be saved. That's revival. That's revival. That's what our hearts are hungry for. But brother, he's not going to wish it on you. I don't know the relationship between God's sovereignty and God and the prayer of God's people, but I know it's there. And I know God uses the words in response to the prayers and the cries of his people. I know that. As sure as you put in the hair, I know if you say, well, let's let God do it, he ain't going to do it. I know he will through his people. And I give my life. Pay the price in agonizing prayer and confession of sin. That the atmosphere might be cleared and the glory of God would come, the spirit would be turned loose. And he'd stab the hearts of men and women and cause sinners to scream out, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Listen, the only testimony between sinners and hell is the kind of getting now, and it ain't working so good. God, help us. We must face our sin. We must face it. My God, I'd rather you tar and feather me and run me out of town than refuse to face the challenge of the message tonight. This world going to hell. This world going to hell, loving its sin, bleeding in its sin, rollicking in its sin. My God, can I call me? Is there something responding? Oh, for times of confession and heart searching and agonizing prayer and spirit-filled witnessing, God-given testimony. That's the need of this hour. God chooses to work on the outside through the people on the inside. That's right. There are three ways that a child of God can testify to lost men and women. So far as I know, they're all the same thing. But I say it's the same thing from three different directions. Will you listen to me? Are you interested or not? Are you? You listening to me? Do you want to be a faithful witness for Christ? Do you long that when we stand at the judgment, sinners won't point their fingers in our faces? God help us. God help us. The first way we can witness to this lost and dying, doomed generation that's missing repentance is by the power of a holy life. There's no substitute for them. As long as Baptists are content to be broad-minded and sinful, God will have to look to somebody else if he ever blesses this generation. Oh, I'm sick and tired of people calling me a holy roller because I preach on Bible holy. Why, I have to say, well, they say, that fellow's not a Baptist. Well, brother, you ain't a Baptist if you don't live holy life. You're a disgrace. You got no right to wear the name Baptist if you do not walk in holy bonds of obedience. Brother, I came from a long line of Baptists that seal that testimony with their blood. And they believed in practice holy living. holiness. How holy are we to be? God says, be ye holy even as I am. That's our holiness. Somebody said, I don't believe in that. I know. That's our trouble now. That's the reason you talk to somebody that don't pay any attention to you. Who's under conviction, beloved, because of your holy life? That's a serious question. Who's under conviction? Because they've watched the spotlessness and the purity of your life. I do not speak of Phariseeism, having somebody going around looking down on people. But I speak of people who've fallen out with sin and head over heels in love with Jesus. That's the kind of holiness I'm talking about. There's no substitute for it. Brother, there's no substitute for it. Oh, my God. A holy life. This generation dying for lack of sin. Holy. I had a book practice in the MP squadron in the Air Corps in the Army when I was a chaplain. They tied my hands. The Catholics and the moderns hated me and followed me and tried to keep me from winning anybody to the Lord, or preaching the gospel, or doing anything else. Those chaplains with their worldly living, their booze and their dirty jokes and their everything. They'd preach in the morning and wallow around in some filthy movie house the rest of the afternoon, have the cocktails at night. That was your chaplain in the army. And they tied my hands so I couldn't do much. And I had an awful time. And so I was limited to gathering about me. Mostly in the army, a few of God's boys. You could tell a Christian in the army, brother, boy, he stuck out. You couldn't tell a Baptist, most of them was chasing women, shooting crap, and getting drunk. But you could tell a Christian. That's right. I know what I'm talking about. You could tell a Christian. They stuck out. And they still stick out. They still stick out. And I gathered them about me, and I put them to witness. And in 30 days' time, I had one buck private in the MP squadron bring 86 soldiers to me and said, preacher, I want you to help me land them for Christ. 86 boys in 1 month's time. You know how he did it? He did it by a godly life. The commanding officer of that MP squadron, that's the toughest in the army, the police, was a Jew. And he said, when I have a boy in my squadron I can't do anything with, I turn him over to Private Stone. And he said, I don't believe in your Jesus, but I believe in what that boy's got. You can't tell me, young man, all you need to get saved and go to walking and obedience. And you can win young men to Christ too. If a buck private in the MP squadron in the army can bring 86 boys in 1 month to Jesus, brother, you could bring some too if God ever masters you. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you the truth. The power of a holy life. The power. There's no substitute for it. You can't invent something to take its place. I believe in the doctrine of election. But I go a lot of places and find people, they're awful strong on election, but they ain't that strong on holiness. And I remind them that nobody's elected except people who walk in holiness. Election is under holiness. He chose us that we should be made holy and without blame before him. That's right, brother. You all rang it down. I'm one of God's elect. I want to see your garments, brother. They'll be pure. If you want to go, that's right. That's right. The power of a holy life. I remember old Mother Green. is in her 80s. In the church I had, the last church I had many years ago out in the state of New Mexico. And one day, in a Sunday morning service, I was led to the Lord, not but anyhow I did. I said, during the invitation, I said, let's break up this thing a little bit. And I want every man who's here this morning, who owes his salvation on the human side to a certain individual, if that individual's here, I want you to go and stand for that person. And you know, there were 70-some-odd men out of that congregation that went over and took old Mother Green's hand. She was left a widow when she was 26 with 3 children. And brother, I'm telling you, that old woman was such a character, she'd walk in a beer joint in my city, and everybody in that beer joint would quit, stand there and respect her. She'd give her testimony, nobody made fun of her. I used to take her with me when I'd go off the whole meeting. And she'd go see the mayor, she'd go see the businessman, she'd go see the postmaster, she'd walk the street, and she'd brag on Jesus. And nobody made fun of them. Everybody in that section of New Mexico knew that old Mother Green used to knew that she walked. Nobody made fun of them. They made fun of our folks. They didn't make fun of them. The power of the Holy Life. So cold of their lips. Close up. How can we testify the men and women on the road to hell? We can do it by hearts of care. Hearts of care. May I ask you something? Do you care? Somebody cares for this old sinner. Brother, I wasn't steamrolled into the kingdom of God. They didn't get me saved by turning the crank or pushing the button. They didn't do it that way when I was a sinner. Somebody cared. Somebody loved my soul. That's right. Somebody wouldn't let me go to hell. Somebody wouldn't take no for an answer. And brother and sister, listen to me. If this world dies, one reason is that the church doesn't know anything about the pain of travail for souls. There's where love for sinners is born. It's born out coming to prayer room on your knees crying to God for that soul. That's where love for sinners is born. That's where it's born. That's reason we sleep well and eat well and work well and worship well and go to church well. Perfectly content to let sinners die and go to hell all about it and lay it off on the last day. Mother love and love for sinners is born in travail. That's where it's born. That's where it's born. Listen, somebody cared for me. Somebody loved me. Thank God. Somebody got me on his heart. Oh, Professor Barnes. Head of the English department in the Christian college. I was a Baptist, but I wasn't saved. I was president of an infidels club in a Christian college. God pity them all. I go around bragging about there wasn't any God. And every Friday night I'd preach my damnable doctrine to hundreds of young students. Yeah, I was born and raised in a Christian home, nurtured in Sunday school, educated in Christian college, given to God as a preacher before I was born. Joined the church upon profession of faith when I was 10 years old. I'm saved till I was 21. There was a senior in college, an infidel tried to be. Made out like there wasn't any God. Had to have something so I could sleep at night. Wasn't willing to repent and forsake of my sin. So revival meeting came along. And old Professor Thomas, he wouldn't give me up. The last year I was in school, that man tormented me and haunted me and loved me and wept over me and prayed for me and put his arms about me, wouldn't you? He'd waylay me, he'd wait, busy as he was. He'd found out my schedule and I'd run into him on the campus. He'd stand there with a hand on my shoulder and said, Ross, I'm not going to let you go to hell. He'd waylay me as I came out of the classroom, put his hand on my shoulder, tears would run down his cheeks. Ross, I love you. I want to see you belong to my Lord. Couldn't get away from it. Couldn't get away from it. Brother, I played poker with Baptists. I played poker with some of the faculty. I put a pint flask of whiskey in my hip pocket as the days of the flask. Got girls drunk on the dance floor, Christian girls. But brother, I'd sneer at them. I'd laugh at them. But brother, I'd tremble at Professor Bond. He loved me. He loved me. We can testify to men and women, but care. By a heart that cares for the souls of men. I'm going to ask you something, brother. I'm going to ask you something. Am I out of this world, or am I on solid ground when I see men? If you see somebody loves you, somebody went after you. That's right. My God, we expect them to be saved in refrigerators. Now, that wasn't the way we got saved. But part of us, somebody wouldn't take no for an answer. Somebody wouldn't ask go to hell. Somebody stood between us and hell. It is personal with them. Somebody cares. Somebody cares. You know any substitute for that? Come on, tell me. Have your big preaching and your big singing, your big meeting, but there ain't nobody going to get saved. There ain't somebody around there that loves people. Loves people. How can we testify to men and women? Bless God, we can testify with lips that have been touched. The fire has come off the coals of God's altar. Tell people of amazing, transforming grace. Walk with me. Tell it. 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 In the New Testament, they threatened people with jail. They didn't shut up, but they couldn't shut them up. Now we beg people to open up with the wound. Oh, God. Don't let this generation go to hell until it's heard from the lips of people the transforming story of what God's done for them. I was in the state of Pennsylvania many years ago, and I went out one day 8 miles out in the country. One of the pastors says, the man out there that everybody's witness to, nobody's ever been able to help him. That every preacher we've ever had here has gone and talked to him, said, I want you to. I said, all right, we'll go. So we journeyed out through the snow, Pennsylvania winter. The man was out in his dairy barn. He's very courteous. He said, take me about 5 minutes, and I'll be through the chores. You'll go on up the house, the wife will make you comfortable, and I'll be there in 5 to 10 minutes. We did. Exactly here he came. Got out of his work clothes and into his other clothes. Came in the farm. His wife and a little 11-year-old boy and the preacher and I. And I witnessed to the man, preached to him. After a while, I asked him if we might pray. He said he had no objection. He believed everything I preached and agreed with everything I said. Slid little one in and out the other. And while we were down on our knees, the pastor was leading the prayer. And I heard a song. I listened. I heard another one. I peeped a little bit. And the little 11-year-old boy over there, nobody said anything to him, but he'd been listening. And there he was over there, just sobbing away. And I got up while the prayer was going on, went over and sat by him. I said, what troubles you, son? Oh, he said, preacher, I'm lost, I'm lost. He listened. His heart has been opened. My witness to his dad is no good. He won't ever help you. He doesn't think I said.
In his head, not out in his heart. They let me old boy part of I believe I led him to the Lord. Three Christmases, four Christmases ago, I believe it was now, three or four, I got a Christmas card from a dear lady in that city. On the inside, you know how they're sometimes blank, on the inside was the letter. And she told me this story. Over yonder in Guadalcanal, during the last war, a stretcher bearer and a chaplain came on a young fellow out in no man's land, lying that fat on his back, dead. They looked in his left hand was a yellow piece of paper, closed like that. And in his finger and thumb was a little pencil. The chaplain reached down, took the pencil out, gave his hand, got the piece of paper, folded it out, and it was a handbill, 9 years old. The boy was lying there dead, was that little 11-year-old boy. He'd gone over to Guadalcanal, 20 years old. He'd gone out that morning and stopped the jet bullet. Evidently it hadn't killed him at once. He's got his pocketbook, I suppose. And for reasons I don't know till I get to glory, he had a circular of that meeting 9 years before in his pocketbook. For there it was, my picture in the middle, announcing the meeting. That little thing. And the boy reaching for a piece of paper, I suppose just got that one, or maybe he looked for it anyhow. He had it in his pocketbook. And while he died, in a blank space right under the picture and my name, a little blank space there, he gave his testimony. I got that piece of paper at home. I've got that little pen. The chaplain sent it to his mother and dad. And while he was dying, that boy, who met the Lord 9 years before that farm home, here's what he did while he died. He wrote out, "Dear Mom, I'm dying. But it's all right, Mom. In the revival meeting Brother Barnard conducted in our city, I gave my heart to Jesus. And Mom, He's with me now." And I guess he must have died. He didn't sign his name. That chaplain sent that pencil and piece of paper. And that little package, you get one? With his watch and his personal belongings. You know what I'm talking about? The old man got it out of the post office. That old man wouldn't listen to me. And he took it home. And his wife undid it. They looked at those things. And then there the wife got that piece of paper and a letter from the chaplain explaining, as I explained it to you. And she read it. And she handed it to Pop and said, "Yeah, Dad, here's the last message from our boy." That old hard-hearted sinner read, "Dear Mom, I'm dying. It's all right, Mom. In the revival meeting Brother Barnum conducted in our city, I gave my heart to Jesus. And Mom, ye wist me not. That testimony broke the heart of that old man. He fell down on his knees and began to pray. Then he looked up and said, Mother, can you tell me how I can find God too? Every once in a while I take out that piece of paper, that little pencil and that letter. I said, okay. I go to witness to a man, he won't hear me. A little boy does. 9 years later on a battlefield, he gives his dying testimony. God uses it to break the heart of his head. Brother, listen to it. Listen to it. God does become real to men and women. Jesus does stay with men in sickness and health and life and death. He's real. And I'll keep going. Maybe some other little 11-year-old boy will hear the story. Be conquered by the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ. Come to a real experience of God. Know him. He'll testify to somebody else. Their hearts will be open to the grace of God.
You never know what God will do with a holy life and a heart that loves and a testimony that's real. Amen.